For the past 40 days, we have walked the Lenten journey under the theme, The Nails of the Cross. Each nail pounded into our Savior represents our sins pounded into his body for us. The nail of pride. My sin of pride pounded into Jesus. The nail of betrayal. My sin of betrayal pounded into Jesus. The nail of envy. My sin of envy pounded into Jesus. The nail of indecision. My sin of indecision pounded into Jesus. The nail of cruelty. My sin of cruelty pounded into Jesus. The nail of hatred. My sin of hatred pounded into Jesus. That was Friday. Dark Friday. Good Friday. Jesus died. He died for me. His body taken down from the cross. He was placed into a dark tomb. The stone rolled into place. But, today is Easter. He is not dead. He is alive. Jesus is alive.
Thank you. peace to you from he who is, as he was, and who is to come. From our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth.
To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us a kingdom and priests to serve God the Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The uncountable multitudes of nations and peoples stand before the Lamb, upon the throne, and cry out with a loud voice.
Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb.
And all the angels around the throne worship him, saying,
blessing and honor, glory and thanksgiving, power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen.
And all the creatures on the earth shout,
Amen.
And all the saints and angels shout,
Amen.
And the people of the Lamb shout,
Amen and Amen.
Alive, alive forevermore. Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
You may be seated. Children, would you please come forward and sit down here, please? All the children, come sit right here. Corey, can you come up? Now, for those of you who are in the first service, you can't answer any of the questions because you know the answers, okay? You know the answers. We don't need it right yet. We'll back it up just a little bit. Tell you what. Okay. All right. So, those of you who weren't in the first service, what do you notice differently about you can't answer someone? What do you notice different about church? Yes, Sawyer. Everything's white, exactly. Friday was black. It was purple in Lent. What else do you notice that's different?
There's flowers.
There's flowers. You got it. Exactly. There used to be, for those of you who are visiting with us during the season of Lent, we studied on the theme of the nails of the cross. And every Wednesday, these children gather together and they sing a song called The Nails, and we put nails. And Friday at church, the last time we put nails there, there was this big pile of nails. Do you remember what the nails represents? Our sins, exactly. So there's no more nails, but we still have six nails, don't we? We shouldn't leave them like that, should we? But first of all, why do you think there aren't any more nails? Why are the nails gone? Sawyer. Exactly. Jesus took away our sins. He took everything away for us, okay? So we don't need the nails to be there anymore. And those six nails there, we need to change them, okay? So, let's see here. Okay. Cullen, could you help me? We don't need that right now. Cullen, could you help me? Come on up here. So that was our last nail, remember, that we looked at? The nail of hatred. And then, Lauren, can you help me? Okay, you can put that in the next one. You put it in from there. Face it. And the next nail that Jesus took away, the nail of indecision, that was cruelty, then indecision. All right. Sophie, does everyone remember what that next nail is? Envy, yes, exactly. That was the nail of envy. Remember last nail? This next nail? Remember what that one is? Oh, we are in cruelty. Betrayal. Very good. Yes. Wednesday, 7 weeks ago almost? The nail of pride. Sawyer, come and put this up. You want a pair of tights, Sawyer? I know somebody else. Now we're complete, aren't we? Now, you know, I think. Now we're complete, aren't we? Right? Transformation has taken place. We've gone from Good Friday to Easter Sunday morning. Now, excuse me, you're going to come up here and you're going to sing your song. So come on up here. Those of you who are visiting with us, you can either come up or go back by your parents, okay? All the ones in front. Follow her, and she'll lead you, okay? We're going to sing, "Did You Hear?" Okay? Alive, alive forevermore. Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Our choir will share with us their choir hymn for today.
To adore.
As we rejoice in the resurrection, we sing the first three verses of hymn 149. God made you alive in Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the written code with its regulations that was against us and that stood opposed to us. He took it away, nailing it to the cross. And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Now just look at the beginning of those words. He says, but you were dead in your sins. But notice the tense. We're dead. Yes, in our sinful nature, we were spiritually dead. We've been dead ever since Adam and Eve plucked from that tree and turned away from God. But this is Easter Sunday morning. This is the fulfillment of God's promise. Think about that for a moment. When Adam and Eve turned their backs on God, He did the unimaginable. He did the exact opposite than what you and I would do. If somebody turns against us, what are we going to do? We're going to lash out at them. But not Jesus. Not our God. Remember, God came to them in the garden and he promised a Savior. He said, I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel. God came to Adam and Eve and said, yes, you really goofed it up, but I'll fix it. I'll fix it by sending my son, and he will crush Satan's head. He will defeat you, Satan. 4,500 years later, here comes Jesus. 4 months ago, we celebrate his birthday, his coming into the world. During January and February, the season of Epiphany, we celebrate the life of our Savior. And for these past 40 days, we have celebrated the death of our Savior, his resurrection. his suffering and death for us. And now today, the resurrection, the fulfillment of it all. This is the day of victory. This is what tells us that what Jesus did is exactly right. Because he says, having canceled the written code with its regulations that was against us, that sort of opposed to us, he took it away, nailing it to the cross. All during Lent, we've been nailing to the cross the things that were against us. Now, you and I have to be very honest with ourselves. Because sometimes we don't like to admit that we've sinned. And there are times that we can even convince ourselves that we're not that bad. I'm not going to go through the whole Ten Commandments with you today, point that out. That's pretty obvious. But I do want to point out one thing to you. Every one of us has certain rules that we expect people to live by, right? We have certain rules of conduct that we want other people to live and how we want them to treat us. Okay? You got those rules, right? This is how I want people to treat me. Imagine having a tape recorder around your neck. And that tape recorder turns on only, it records only when you go against your own personal rules. On the last day, would you want that plate back as you stand before God? Would you want that plate back and try to say to God, well, God, I haven't been that bad. And then this recording goes back. And it shows all the times that we've broken even our own rules. But what does Paul say here? Every one of them was taken to the cross and it was nailed there at the cross. It was nailed there for you and for me. And today's Easter. And so he says, and having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. That's today. So nailing to the cross is Good Friday. The victory is today. Now, to really kind of understand this whole passage, we have to put ourselves back into the time of Jesus. We don't do this in our world today, but back in Jesus' day, you know, when the army was victorious in battle, they would have a victory march. You have a victory parade. We don't have too many of those anymore. And the victorious general of his army would walk through the streets, and everybody would hail them. And the prisoners would be in chains led behind them. Today is the victory march for Christ. He is the victorious general. And in chains right behind him, sin and death and the devil. But you know who's walking with Jesus right now? You are. This is your day as well. Because Jesus did this for you. Remember, it says that he made you alive with Christ. You are alive. Through the power of the gospel message, he's brought that beautiful gift of hope and life and salvation into your heart, dipped in the waters of baptism. You are his very own. You are victorious because Christ is victorious. And it is this power that makes us spiritually alive and spiritually strong. But I'd like to ask you today, how are you doing spiritually? I've been permitted in my time here as pastor to sit with a lot of people as they're drawing their last breath on this earth. And I can tell you, and you've heard me say this before, I've seen incredible Christians, marvelous Christians, who even though very physically weak, weak to the point of death, yet just leave this world screaming with spiritual joy, with spiritual strength, because Christ has been with us. That's what he offers you. That's what he gives to you. It is the power of this gospel, and we can't underestimate, believe it, trust it. Yesterday, the Lord presented us this beautiful white blanket out there. And I was trying to remember that in the midst of my shuffling. And one of our dear members, Vera Meyer, was taken to the hospital. And in the midst of my shuffling, I felt I needed to go over and visit her. And so I'm still got all my shoveling gear on and visit with her, and I'm walking out, and there's a lady sitting in the waiting room crying. I have a sinful nature, I'm just going to tell you that. And there's part of me that's like, you're dirty, you're tired, go home. But as I'm walking the door, I'm like, no. Went in the room with her mom. Don't know her mom. Never met her before. Never met this lady before. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. I have no idea what God's going to do with that gospel message. That's for him. But I trust the power of the gospel. And in the power of the gospel, I know there is the promise of hope and peace and comfort for when we live and for when we die. And that's what God says to you today, too. This is your day, brothers and sisters. It's your day of victory because Christ did this all for you. Believe the power of the gospel. Trust in God. Trust also in Jesus. And know the power that comes from being spiritually alive in Jesus. Yes. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
We say.
Thank you.